How much smarter are you with a phone or computer than without? You're vastly smarter, actually. You know, you can answer any question pretty much instantly, any calculation, that your phone's memory is essentially perfect. Your phone can remember videos, pictures, everything perfectly. Your phone is already an extension of you. You're already a cyborg. That phone is an extension of yourself. It's just that the data rate, the communication rate between you and the cybernetic extension of yourself that is your phone and computer is slow. It's very slow. It's like a tiny straw of information flow between your biological self and your digital self. And we need to make that tiny straw like a giant river, a huge high bandwidth interface. It's an interface problem, data rate problem. Solve the data rate problem, then I think we can hang on to human-machine symbiosis through the long term.
Elon Musk explained the goal of Neuralink, his brain-machine interface startup, is to allow humans to achieve a symbiosis with artificial intelligence, and that by merging with AI, humans will be able to keep up with AI. Musk plans to begin human trials on an early version of Neuralink intended to treat brain injuries. Musk said, ultimately, we can achieve a symbiosis with artificial intelligence. This is not a mandatory thing. This is something you can choose to have if you want. This is going to be really important at a civilization level scale. Even in a benign AI scenario, we will be left behind. With a high bandwidth brain-machine interface, we can go along for the ride and have the option of merging with AI.
So for the initial device, it's read, write, and every channel, about 1,024 channels. All day battery life, recharges overnight, has quite a long range. This would connect to your phone and it would be communicating by essentially Bluetooth low energy to the device in your head. That's why I say it, in a lot of ways it is like a Fitbit in your skull with tiny wires. And then you would not be able to see the device at all. You would look completely normal and just have a small scar under your hair.
Many scholars believe that advances in artificial intelligence will someday lead to a post-scarcity economy where intelligent machines can outperform humans on nearly every domain. The question of what such a world might look like and whether specific scenarios constitute utopias or dystopias are the subject of lively debate. Most scientists believe that AI research will at some point lead to the creation of machines that are as intelligent or more intelligent than human beings in every domain of interest. There is no physical law precluding particles from being organized in ways that perform even more advanced computations than the arrangements of particles in human brains. Therefore, superintelligence is physically possible. In addition to potential algorithmic improvements over human brains, a digital brain can be many orders of magnitude larger and faster than a human brain, which was constrained in size by evolution to be small enough to fit through a birth canal. While there is no consensus on when artificial intelligence will outperform humans, many scholars argue that whenever it does happen, an introduction of a second species of intelligent life onto the planet will have far-reaching implications. Researchers often disagree with one another, both about what types of post-AI scenarios are most likely and about what types of post-AI scenarios would be most desirable. Some AI researchers argue that AI will never become as intelligent as humans because the human race will already likely have destroyed itself before research has time to advance sufficiently to create artificial general intelligence. AGI advocates see the potential benefits of such a superintelligent entity and suggest that it could solve technological and environmental problems or pursue goals such as the abolition of suffering, better known as the great good.
But even that could be enhanced significantly. I think the two things that are needed for a future that we would look at and conclude is good, most likely, is we have to solve that bandwidth constraint with a direct neural interface. I think a high bandwidth interface to the cortex, so that we can have a digital tertiary layer that's more fully symbiotic with the rest of us.
Nick Bostrom has argued that AGI could be a dangerous threat to humanity, as it may result in an unrecognized being. Whether the benefits of such an entity could be trusted to have a benign intention is another matter. Some, and a minority in particular of those who investigate the ramifications of advanced AI, hold that the technology will inevitably inflict itself upon humanity without human intervention, a process known as the uploading of AI. They take this outcome as an undesirable one and believe that it would be preferable to prevent the development of AI of human level and superhuman intelligence, most commonly by holding out for the possibility of artificial intelligence to fail to live up to its expectations. The problem with this line of thinking, critics contend, is that it relies on the gradual development of AI, a development that has been showing no sign of abating, and fails to account for the likelihood of an abrupt jump in human capabilities.
So one would be to make faster progress now, so you get to that point sooner. When hardware is less developed, you get less hardware overhang. However, the current speed of AI progress is a fairly hard variable to change very much because there are big forces pushing on it. So perhaps the higher elasticity option is to ensure that whoever gets there first has enough of a lead that they're able to slow down for a few months, let us say, to go slow during the transition.
If a dominant superintelligent machine were to conclude that human survival is an unnecessary risk or a waste of resources, the result could be human extinction. This could occur if the machine, programmed without respect for human values, unexpectedly gains superintelligence through recursive self-improvement or manages to escape from its containment in an AI box scenario. This could also occur if the first superintelligent AI was programmed with an incomplete or inaccurate understanding of human values, either because the task of installing the AI with human values was too difficult or impossible, due to a buggy initial implementation of the AI, or due to bugs accidentally being introduced, either by its human programmers or by the self-improving AI itself, in the course of refining its codebase. Ostrom and others argue that human extinction is probably the default path that society is currently taking, in the absence of substantial preparatory attention to AI safety. The resultant AI might not be sentient and might place no value on sentient life. The resulting hollow world, devoid of life, might be like a Disneyland without children.
We've got the cortex and the limbic system, which seem to work together pretty well. They've got good bandwidth, whereas the bandwidth to our digital tertiary layer is weak. So I think if we can solve that bandwidth issue, and then AI can be widely available. So I think it's extremely important that it be widespread and that we solve the bandwidth issue. And if we do those things, then it will be tied to our consciousness, tied to our will, tied to the sum of individual human will, and everyone would have it, so it would be sort of still a relatively even playing field. In fact, it would be probably more egalitarian than today.
Elon Musk's Neuralink may be the only hope for humanity to avoid the extinction scenario from advanced AI. As technology continues to improve, future iteration of Neuralink's BMI may be able to offer a symbiosis with AI, thus avoiding a possible digital apocalypse. However, even if one day we can merge with AI, it is by no means a silver bullet to threat of a malevolent AI going rogue and taking control over the planet. It may also be possible for an AI to come to view its human counterpart a threat and possibly consider enslavement, or even a preemptive attack. Neuralink's brain implant could be used to allow humans to connect directly with artificial intelligences, a system that, if successful, could be used to help solve some of the current problems and even improve human health.
I mean, you could solve blindness. You could solve paralysis. You can solve hearing. You can solve a lot just by interfacing with the cortex. And really the thing that would change from interfacing with the cortex versus deep brain systems is kind of the length of the electrode. So we just need kind of longer wires and to adjust the robot in order to access deeper regions of the brain.
If Neuralink proves to work, it will be the first true neural interface, an implant that will be inserted into the human brain, allowing a person's brain activity to directly interface with an artificially intelligent system. But as the technology is still in its infancy, we are unsure of what will happen once we finally get set up to keep communicating with AI. The final question is, would you want to merge with AI if or when the possibility arrives? Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing, ringing the bell, and enabling notifications to never miss videos like this.